I think what maybe a good way to start, we're going to talk about a few cases. I have an introductory slide that I'll probably skip just in the interest of time. But what I'd like to do is to have the panel introduce themselves. Everyone knows Pam, but Dr. Welton, will you go ahead and introduce yourself?
I'm Mark Welton. I'm a colorectal surgeon at Stanford.
I'm Jeff Norton. I'm an upper abdominal surgeon at Stanford as well.
Tom Hope from UCSF, nuclear medicine physician.
Is this how you turn on?
I think they're on.
Okay, I'm on. Good. I'm Justin Annis. I do hereditary neuroendocrine tumors at Stanford.
My name is Yan Li. I'm the medical oncology from Kaiser, Oakland. And also, I'm one of the lead in Kaiser, trying to initiate how we're going to do subspecialty care for our GI oncology patient, and especially how we're going to design subspecialty care for our neuroendocrine tumor patients.
Emily Bergsland, medical oncology at UCSF.
And I want to specifically welcome Jan, because I think subspecialty oncology care within Kaiser is long overdue, and so congratulations, and we're supportive.
Thank you.
Okay, so this is meant to, these are real cases, I'm told. I don't know the individuals in the cases. Some of you may. We will try to keep it short and get as many cases as we can in the next 45 minutes or so, and then wrap up. I was going to start with sort of an algorithm for NET treatment, but I think the algorithm may become clear as we discuss how to approach this. I will say that I have my own sort of algorithm for patients, which is right here, sort of initial management tips. And I think that this is a diagnosis that once you get, it's good to step back, take a deep breath, listen to what you've heard, and then ask around. This is not one where you necessarily have to dive into treatment that day, yesterday, even that week, sometimes not even that month. I think that there is some sense of urgency when there's a lot of disease. I know that that's a relative term to many of you. If you have a spot in the liver, that seems like a lot of disease. But if your physician or radiologist are concerned about the amount of disease in the liver that might compromise liver function, or if there's already compromised organ function or symptoms due to a lump or bump, that's the reason to act a little bit quicker. We already talked about the poorly differentiated grade 3 or the high grade. Those tend to behave a little bit more aggressively, and so we want to be ready to treat those a little bit earlier. And every once in a while, unbeknownst to a lawyer, there was a prior scan that showed something, and now you see something more and you say, aha, there's been growth. And that can be very helpful at trying to determine a growth rate that can be predictive of how the tumor will behave. Take a deep breath. If you have small volume, low grade, even if it's spread, if there are no symptoms and it's spread, many of those people don't need treatment at all. They can just be watched or treated with the mildest treatments first. And you want to be aware, we talked about pathology and how that can be misinterpreted sometimes. A fine needle aspirate's a little skinny needle put in the middle of a tumor and taken out, and a pathologist says neuroendocrine tumor. You want to think twice about how you interpret that biopsy, because it can be sampling artifact or there may be insufficient cells to arrive at a good diagnosis. We talked a little bit about scans earlier on and that how there are better scans than others, and some of the questions that I have from the audience are relate to scans. I might ask Tom Hope to clarify some of that in the context of a case. And as I mentioned, equivocal pathology, G3, well-differentiated, poorly differentiated, this is still an area that's evolving in how we interpret the pathology. And one last thing is, I myself have mistaken fatigue and some swelling as just something that's really due to the tumor itself, but in fact, it could be carcinoid heart. So I have a low threshold for thinking, well, how's my heart? Should I get an echo? We do that periodically, more in some that we worry about than others. But that's something to keep on your forefront. So with that, let's talk about some cases. So here's a 47-year-old woman with a non-functional, meaning no or hormonal syndrome, a metastatic, well-differentiated appendiceal neuroendocrine tumor. This is really what we used to call carcinoid. Diagnosed 14 years ago with low abdominal pain, underwent hysterectomy, appendectomy, found to have neuroendocrine tumor of the appendix. It was WHO grade 2, so they said, well, it's not grade 1, it's not the lowest the most well-behaved, is grade 2, and the KI-67 was 10%. 4 years ago, they developed abdominal pain. A CT scan now shows multiple liver lesions, and a biopsy confirmed neuroendocrine tumor, and this time it was biopsied in WHO grade 1. So earlier this morning, there was a question, well, do tumors go from grade 1 to grade 2? More so in pancreatic, sometimes it's just an error. They don't go from grade 2 to grade 1. So my guess is that the first one was just kind of a miss. They miscalled it grade 2. Could be wrong, but that would be one of the possibilities. In any case, 2 years ago, disease progression seen on CT scan, liver, peritoneum, that's the lining of the abdomen, some spots in the bone, received radiation to the spots in the bone because there's some pain, and now the patient has fatigue, some little bit of low back pain, some abdominal pain, a little bit of sense of bloating, discomfort, nausea, and diarrhea. Boy, what a way to end the day. Okay, so they had a history of kidney stones, family history, father had prostate cancer, paternal grandfather had colon cancer. Family history is becoming more and more important to try to identify syndromes that you just heard about. Physical examination, we call ECOG performance status 1, meaning they had some symptoms of the disease. 2 is when the symptoms really start interfering with daily activities. But this person's getting around fine, they just have some abdominal pain, and all the labs look normal, including a urinary 5-HIA. So there's a scan there, and Tom, I don't know if you can see that scan. Maybe not. And there's also an octreo scan, which is the old technology before gallium scans. And this scan shows that there's a, you can see on those green lines there, those are lines that the radiologist or Pam put on this scan. There's that organ on the right side of the picture is the spleen, or actually the left side of the abdomen. Oh, go ahead, Tom. So something in the spleen, something in the liver. And Tom, you're going to have to read the octreo scan. I always say that nuclear medicine folks have a vivid imagination. So Tom, how do you read that?
Well, now that we have a dotatate PET, we don't need an imagination.
Yeah. We might not need you, because I can read dotatate PETs.
So, I mean, the take-home point here is there's obviously a lot of liver disease, but additionally, there's peritoneal disease, and also, I think that's the bladder and the inferior abdomen, depends on the time point, but there could be stuff down in the pelvis as well. So, yeah, there's this metastasis in the spleen, liver, peritoneal disease, so multiple sites of disease.
So this patient, I should ask the group, Emily, what's your first guess? You have a patient who's been resected once and now has recurrence in multiple sites. What would be your first line of defense at this point?
Yeah, I mean, I think that your history is perfect. I mean, it outlines, it really depends on the extent of the disease, the rate of growth. And when it's involving multiple sites, our sort of ability to make a difference, we think doing surgery drops down. There are some exceptions to that, but I would say typically in this case with progression in multiple areas, we'd be thinking something more along the lines of total body treatment, which, you know, if it's positive on an octreo scan and PRT is available, that would be a very, I think, intriguing option. And then the other option that's approved in this setting would be everolimus, which is an oral agent.
So Dr. Norton, earlier in the morning, there were a number of surgical questions, so I answered them all for you, so you don't have to.
It's good.
So this person has a spot in their spleen, maybe a handful of spots in the liver, probably things that you could shell out if you wanted to. They also have intraperitoneal disease and some spots in the bone. What do you think about this as a surgeon?
Yeah, I think it's too much disease really to operate on. I mean, I think that, I've popularized resection of metastatic neuroendocrine tumors, and I think this particular patient, you know, it's a bit unusual for an appendiceal neuroendocrine tumor because they usually do very, very well. But obviously, they can be malignant, and her tumor has progressed. So I think that some kind of systemic therapy would be better. So either chemotherapy or possibly PRRT. And I know that you gave her PRRT, so that's probably a good choice because her DOTA scan's positive.
That is cheating, but yes. As is often the case, Dr. Norton is correct. She was enrolled in the NETRF-1 trial, which Tom already shared with you, and had significant shrinkage. Tom, I don't know if there's any take-home messages you want to add to this, or?
There was significant shrinkage, yes.
Yes. so So he says that because many of our therapies, that our therapies, meaning Dr. Kunz and Dr. Bergsland, the medical oncologists, our therapies for neuroendocrine tumors tend not to shrink the disease. They tend to control the growth of the disease. And so I think that one important question whenever a physician recommends a treatment is to step back and ask, what are the goals of that treatment? Am I trying to relieve symptoms associated with the lump that's pushing on things? Or am I trying to control growth, keep that disease from getting worse? Of course, we always try to do both, but many of our treatments are better at controlling growth than they are at shrinking the tumor. And this, the NETTER-1 trial showed us that a certain proportion of patients have significant shrinkage, not as many as we'd like, but it's probably the best we have at getting shrinkage of these diseases. So in the trial, Tom, was it 20% who had significant shrinkage?
Just under 20%.
Yeah. But also important in that trial is that even the people who did not have significant shrinkage, the people who had stable disease, they did very well in terms of long-term stability of their disease. And so it's not, you don't have to have shrinkage of the disease in order to be a winner in this particular type of treatment. Okay. Case two, a 70-year-old man with newly diagnosed poorly differentiated neuroendocrine tumor or neuroendocrine carcinoma of the rectum, WHO grade 3, so it's a high-grade tumor, large cell type, don't worry what that means. Ki-67 is 95%. We've been talking about Ki-67s of 2, 5, 10%. This is 95%. That means that tumor's growing. Lots of cells are ready to divide. And that was reviewed at an academic center. You know, we're a little bit arrogant. If it was done someplace else, we'd want to check it and make sure that we felt confident that that was the right diagnosis. But it was done, and we believe it. And this was on a screening colonoscopy. The person had no symptoms. And so the person just went in for a routine screening, and well, lo and behold, they find this tumor. Otherwise, the patient's feeling fine. No bleeding, no symptoms, no pain, no weight loss. At this time, the performance status is zero, meaning no symptoms whatsoever. The person feels perfectly fine. And when they get a physical examination by a good colorectal surgeon, Dr. Welton, they say the mass can be felt with his long finger at 5 centimeters. And that's important. Why, Dr. Welton?
Well, for these lesions, for any lesion, you're trying to assess whether or not you can take it out through the anus. We can do low anterior resections, which are abdominal approaches, or we can do transanal resections. And if you can feel it and get your finger above it, then in select tumor types, we'll actually just take it out through the anus so you don't have a major abdominal operation.
And the other part, the low anterior resection that I was talking about, is internal plumbing. So you don't have to have a colostomy most of the time with that procedure.
Right. It's also high enough up that it's very unlikely. It's less likely that you'll have to give somebody a permanent colostomy. Having said that, I don't know how heavy this person is, and that does make it harder to get to if they're really quite heavy.
So we trust Dr. Welton, but we decided to get an MRI anyway, and sure enough, there's a 2-centimeter tumor right at the top of his finger, and it was staged as T2. It hadn't gone through the muscle wall. It's relatively early stage tumor. And the CT scan that was done shows no evidence of spread. So this is a particularly difficult case. I have to say, when I saw this, I said, I don't know what to do. I'm going to let...
George, next slide has
the MRI.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, I still don't know what to do. Tom, why don't you describe the MRI? Anything that's not white in the middle, I think, is tumor.
The white thing in the middle is the tumor. I mean, with MR, it's just really important to realize that not all MRs are created equal, and particularly in the rectum. And so it says rectal protocol, and Stanford is lucky to have Sharay Sasanawala, who's a phenomenal MR specialist in body MR and rectal MR imaging. But, you know, this isn't true across all sites. And yeah. So for staging of rectal tumors in particular, I'm not sure T2 versus T3 distinction means much in this setting, but it's really important to have a very good rectal protocol MR for the staging of primary tumor. So, you know. But you can see that they have markers over this in green there measuring the tumor, the white thin there.
So I think it's time to discuss what to do in a particularly difficult situation, because this is a healthy person who has a small tumor. It hasn't even invaded through the wall. If this were a standard adenocarcinoma, Dr. Welton, what do you think we'd do?
Well, it depends on if you're me or one of my partners who disagree with me.
but you're here now, so whatever you want.
So if it was a regular adenocarcinoma, I would discuss with this patient a transanal excision of that tumor and tell him that if it's actually a T2 lesion, that we could give him chemoradiation therapy afterwards, and I think he'd have a very good outcome. All of my partners would do a low anterior resection, the major abdominal operation. I'm still very happy with our results with the transanal approach followed by chemoradiation therapy. I would emphasize one thing that you called out here, that our pathologist reviewed that. We have a paper actually that Dimitri Kalivas is either the first or the last author on, looking at a pathology review at Stanford, and we change the diagnosis 20% of the time. So it's not just us being arrogant, which we are.
We've looked at that specifically in NETS, and it's about 30%.
Okay, yeah. So we definitely are arrogant, but it's actually really important to know that the person you're talking to knows what they're talking about when you're making these very important decisions. So I'm strongly in favor of that, and I also would agree that the MRI is very institutional dependent. I actually trust my finger more than I trust the MRI still.
That's why I said that, yeah. So now remember, that's an adenocarcinoma. That's not what we're talking about here. What if this were a well-differentiated neuroendocrine tumor, Dr. Welton? How does that influence?
And it's still 2.2 centimeters in size?
Yep.
Then I would offer the patient a transanal excision still for a 2.2 centimeter lesion. Yep. My partners would still do a low anterior resection.
So the clincher here is that it's high grade. And high grade tumors tend to spread early and fast and far. And so we wouldn't want to subject this person to a major surgery. We've all had a number of these who, by the time they recover from surgery, there are spots in the liver, bone, lungs, and elsewhere. So the high grade tumors have to be looked at completely differently. And we think that they have such an early propensity for spread that we're oftentimes inclined to give early chemotherapy to try to kill those microscopic cells. Pam, you want to comment on?
Sure, and I think this is a case that actually comes up with a fair amount of frequency where we're really debating the order in which. So we might not put surgery first in this case and might start with we talked earlier, the platinum-based chemotherapy, so either cisplatin etoposide or carboplatin etoposide first. We might even consider radiation therapy early and really use time to teach us a little bit more about the biology of this specific individual's disease. And I think, you know, we probably all have a handful of cases that we've all treated a little bit differently in it. But I think I would probably favor using either chemotherapy first or radiation first rather than surgery first.
Jan, I don't know if you have any comments. You're welcome.
Yeah, I think I totally agree in terms of the before we decided to put through patients through surgery, this is certainly a high-grade tumor that have a high incidence of metastatic disease. I probably will recommend a PET scan, make sure that patient truly does not have metastatic disease, and this is the perfect case that it needs a multidisciplinary inputs to be discussed in the tumor boards. I think ideally the trimodality in terms of chemotherapy, radiation, surgery, it should be considered in a healthy 70 years old patient, but in terms of what the sequence of doing these treatment probably needs a discussion. I personally probably also will favor to do chemo or chemo plus radiation first rather than go for surgery first. Yeah. Also another point that I just wanted to point it out is that I probably will really talking to the pathologist and also the GI doctors to make sure the biopsy specimen is really adequate. At times it's rare, but somehow we do see mixed components of neuroendocrine tumor and the adenocarcinoma, and they can coexist, although that is rare cases, but I just want to make sure the specimen is not super scandy, so the pathology is truly represent what is showing here.
So we're not going through this to confuse you, but just sort of to highlight the nuances that can go on and how one small change in the pathology can change completely our sequence of events and the way we think about it. In fact, Tom, you're a nuclear medicine guy. What kind of scan would you think you might do for this?
Yeah, I mean, I think that's an important point here. This is a Ki-6795 grade 3 poorly differentiated. So this is the type of patient who actually wouldn't benefit classically from a somatostatin receptor PET. These are typically more hypermetabolic rather than somatostatin-expressing tumors, so this patient would be more appropriately staged with an FDG PET, although some sites would actually get both.
Yeah, and the FDG PETs are the standard PETs that most carcinomas get. Okay, so I think we milked that. Case
George,
three.
Can I make just one general point? This is exactly the type of conversation we have at a multidisciplinary tumor board. So you've heard of tumor boards. We actually sit down once a week, and I think UCSF does a similar thing, where we discuss complicated cases and bounce ideas off each other. It's really useful.
54-year-old woman with recent diagnosis of a functional, well-differentiated pancreatic neuroendocrine tumor. This one's producing insulin with liver and bone metastasis. This is a low grade, grade 2 with a low Ki-67 of 2%. 4 months ago, had difficulty with concentration, finding words, and was seen in the emergency room for agitation. Was found to have a very low blood sugar. And the very low blood sugar was, of course, accompanied by a very high insulin level, which was driving the blood sugar low. So presumably, this insulin was coming from the tumor. The CT scan, in fact, confirmed that there's a large pancreatic body and tail mass, so kind of on the back side of the pancreas, and multiple spots in the liver with no lung lesions. An octreous scan confirmed that the pancreas was positive on the octreous scan, and so were the liver metastases. And there's also some evidence on the octreous scan of maybe some spots in the bone that were not previously seen on the CT scan. So fairly advanced metastatic insulin-producing pancreatic neuroendocrine tumor. Asymptomatic besides anxiety over the diagnosis and had no bone pain despite the spots in the sacrum. Family history, some high blood pressure, some benign pituitary tumor at age 78. Paternal aunt had leukemia, no other cancers or endocrine disorders. ECOG performance status 0, I mean, they felt perfectly fine once you corrected the glucose. And the labs actually look pretty good. The liver tests and kidney tests look good. I'm actually going to go to Justin first. What are you thinking about this, Dr. Annis?
So I think this is one of those cases where it comes up.
You want to get a little closer to the mic?
You can hear me? Where you start to think, so there's two questions here. One is managing the hypoglycemia, and the other one is whether or not we're thinking about a hereditary condition. So from the second point, this is pretty unlikely. I think you sort of go through the chart and you speak with them and you sort of look for signs, but that's probably low likelihood. And then the second issue, I guess along the lines of considering the hereditary diagnosis, you would want to look at the pathology. One low likelihood possibility is that there's diffuse islet hyperplasia, where you would then be leaning more towards there being an underlying hereditary condition. So setting that aside, I think your next issue is really managing the hypoglycemia, and obviously you think you'd want to progress towards a therapeutic option quickly rather than delaying. And I think the being hospitalized or being is that what happened here would really drive your decision making towards acting quickly and instituting something like even diazoxide or something very quickly to prevent hypoglycemia.
So people can die of low glucose. When the glucose goes low enough, your brain's not working, you can go into a coma. So it's very, very important that we manage these. And some people amazingly adapt over time and don't think they have a problem, but they have to set the alarm at midnight to have a glass of juice, otherwise they don't feel very well. So that's a good hint that they have a problem. Tom, can I let you go ahead and just comment on the scans again, since you're card-carrying?
Yeah, as you described earlier, there are liver metastases or lesions throughout the liver. Those are the orange spots, and then also a large pancreatic mass near the tail. And then on the sort of top left there is an image of the whole body from the octreous scan showing, I'm assuming there's the sacral lesion they were talking about.
And in the liver in general, dark spots are bad. So you can see the right side, the CT scan, with some dark spots. So what's the next best step? I'm glad we have an endocrinologist here, because sometimes that's very helpful. It's not necessarily within our repertoire. But Emily, I'm going to start with you, if you don't mind.
Yeah, so I think the first step is stabilizing the patient, because as George said, the low blood sugars are really a difficult problem. And you know, the tools could be just frequent meals, cornstarch, which can help tide people overnight. Octreotide can be used, but there's actually some caveats to its use, and it's actually best done in somebody with a scan that's positive, an octrea scan or DOTATOC or DOTATATE scan that's positive. But some even recommend doing it in the hospital, and it has to do with the fact that some people actually have lower blood sugars if you give them octreotide, and you know, it can be very safe, but it's one of those caveats with this disease. And then everolimus is something that you could consider, because there's actually some limited data suggesting that everolimus actually can inhibit the insulin signaling, and it can actually help stabilize blood sugars. And interestingly, for those of you who are familiar with everolimus, one of its side effects is high blood sugars, which actually can be helpful in this setting. But the problem is all of this is sort of just temporizing. And I think this is a case where, unlike my usual sort of slow stepwise pattern where I use one therapy at a time and then at progression I switch to another, this is a case where I actually think the patient would benefit from something that actually shrinks the tumor, because proportionally you can imagine that you can get the hormone levels down which are causing the symptoms. And your options there are essentially going to be things like chemotherapy, embolization to the liver, which doesn't help the outside of the liver disease like in the pancreas, or actually considering a surgery, which again highlights the importance of a multidisciplinary tumor board. And this is a case where I would actually consider debulking surgery if it was possible.
So I was going to let Jeff say that, but I didn't want to give him the credit right up front. So Dr. Norton, you know, I always quote you as seeing the guy who comes in with the unresectable tumor, so I took it out.
Yeah, I think that one thing you need to, several things are important about insulinomas. First of all, they're usually benign and difficult to localize. So this is a very unusual case. And as everybody mentioned, the hypoglycemia is a big problem. And there are some drugs to treat that, like octreotide and also diazoxide, but they're not very good. So one thing like I like to think about is if we can remove all tumor, that would be really the best. But in a situation like this, we're going to be able to remove the pancreas tumor and some of the liver tumor, but not all of it. So the surgery is not going to be curative. But it would be, if it can be done safely, it would be the advantage of debulking surgery would help manage the hypoglycemia and the other, and also probably prolong her life and hopefully give her some other opportunities for different types of treatment. So I would favor debulking surgery.
Justin, you?
Yeah, I was just going to add that in this sort of high-risk transition period, you could use continuous glucose monitoring as an alarm system for the patients so that they can be woken up should their sugar start to drop, because they may not be aware of it as they're sleeping.
So I think the simplistic way of thinking about that for me is that this person may have had this tumor for 10 or 15 years, but only recently became symptomatic with the low glucoses, and it may have taken that tumor bulk that she currently has in order to trigger that. So if somebody like Dr. Norton can remove 80 or 90% of the tumor bulk, that might turn back the clock. So it might be years before the tumor regrows to a point where that's an important issue. So that's a type of surgery that we only think about for neuroendocrine. We don't do that for other cancers. Okay, another case. I'm going to try to get one more in here. 43-year-old a gentleman with newly diagnosed well-differentiated pancreatic neuroendocrine tumor. 1 year ago, hospitalized for abdominal pain associated with nausea and vomiting. Labs showed some elevated pancreas enzymes, amylase and lipase. CT scan showed some pancreatitis, so inflammation of the pancreas, but they didn't find a mass. 5 months ago, so about a half year later, I was hospitalized again with pancreatitis, and the CT scan this time shows a 2.9 by 3 centimeter mass in the pancreas. Biopsy was done and revealed a well-differentiated neuroendocrine tumor, WHO grade 2 with a Ki-67 of 5%. Review symptoms, the patient had lost about 12 pounds, had some mild upper abdominal pain, but it was otherwise doing fine. And in terms of medical history, had some kidney stones, multiple lipomas removed, large left adrenal adenoma removed. Family history, 5 sisters, most of whom had lipomas. One had an ovarian tumor removed, but married with 2 healthy children at home. ECOG performance status 0, meaning no current symptoms right now. Calcium was high, 12. Parathyroid was high. And Dr. Annis, you're getting all the cases here. So although they may come in through a gastroenterologist or the emergency room and may see me or Pam or Emily or Jan, we would always appreciate help of somebody who's more familiar with the MEN syndromes and also management of endocrine issues. So Justin, why don't you go ahead and take a shot at that?
Sure. So I think first we're thinking about what are the acute issues for this individual. So this does look like it's likely MEN1. And so one of the things we might be thinking about, since it's symptomatic in terms of the hypercalcemia, that there's going to be a management decision, potentially surgery. So you sort of want to get a better sense of what's going on. So is this hypercalcemia dangerous to this individual? So 12 is high, but on the lower end of where we'd be high risk. But you might want to check an INIs, make sure it's not, we're not being misled here. Maybe an EKG, make sure that from the calcium standpoint, they're stable or safe. The second thing is for the MEN1, we'd also be thinking about there possibly being a pituitary adenoma or syndrome. So even though we're going to send off genetic testing, I probably would, on the basis of those 2 other findings and the age, think about doing looking at the pituitary outright. And then the third thing, though low likelihood, again, we're thinking possible surgery in the future, I would exclude an elevated metanephrine just to be sure that we're not going to put a patient into a high-risk surgery situation. And then that's the individual patient. Then, of course, we have to do the testing and think about the family after that. So those were my initial thoughts on reading.
So Dr. Norton, you're known for doing big abdominal surgeries, but I think relatively few people know that you also operate in the neck. Do you want to talk about the parathyroid surgery?
Or? Yeah, so I think this patient definitely has MEN1. So the lipomas, the MEN1 gene was cloned on a lipoma that I removed when I was at the NIH in patients with MEN1. They always have multiple abnormal glands, and normally you deal with the hyperparathyroidism first. We used to think it was hyperplasia, but now it's pretty clear it's a clonal abnormality of the parathyroid glands, but all the glands are involved. So the standard operation would be a 3.5 gland resection. And then—
Dr. Norton, can you tell people where the parathyroid glands are located?
They're in the neck. Yeah, they're in the neck. So parathyroid next to the thyroid in the neck. So the next thing is the pancreas. So the most common cause of death in MEN1 patients is the pancreatic neuroendocrine tumors metastasized to different distant sites. The problem is these patients have multiple tumors in the pancreas, so it's hard to choose. It's not curative when you operate on them usually, so it's hard to choose which patients to operate on. Most of the NANETS guidelines and the European guidelines suggest that a size criteria for malignancy is important, and it turns out the size criteria for malignancy in these tumors is 2 centimeters, and this tumor is 3.9, or maybe 2.9 centimeters, so I would try to take it out. And as he mentioned, it's possible that they do have a pituitary tumor. That's part of the syndrome, but they don't usually get pheo, so I wouldn't get the catecholamines and that type of thing. But the pituitary tumor, we usually screen that by measuring prolactin levels.
So Dr. Kunz, I'm always humbled by every time I think I understand neuroendocrine tumors, somebody comes to me with something that leaves me scratch my head. Could this parathyroid hormone be coming from the pancreas tumor and not have parathyroid disease at all?
I can answer that.
I might ask my endocrinologist. So, I think we have there is a syndrome where there is a protein called parathyroid-related peptide, but it's measured differently than this. So I think this is primary hyperparathyroidism. Did I do that right, endocrinologist? Yeah.
Yeah, I would agree with that.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, it turns out the intact parathyroid hormone assay is so good that it doesn't, ectopic production of parathyroid hormone is ruled out. So nowadays we measure the intact hormone. So since the whole hormone, it's actually only comes from the parathyroid.
But to finish that thought, I do actually have a very recently diagnosed patient who presented, young patient, presented with hypercalcemia. We thought probably had MEN1, but in fact actually had a low parathyroid hormone level, and actually was his pancreas was producing this sort of mimic of parathyroid hormone called PTH-related peptide. So that for sure can happen, George.
So I'm going to switch to some of the questions from the audience. Emily, do all neuroendocrine tumors have receptors? And if you get a gallium scan and it doesn't light up, how confident are you that you're tumor-free and don't have receptors?
Well, I would say that there are receptors of all types on cells, but in terms of the somatostatin receptors, the majority of well-differentiated tumors will express those and will be positive on an Octrea scan or a gallium-68 scan. It's not everybody, and I think that there's some debate about how best to treat people if they're negative. I will say that on the old Octrea scans, when people were negative, I wasn't really sure. I'm a little more confident on the gallium-68s when they're negative. But I think that it's true that not all patients have positive tumors, and most likely the ones that are negative are the higher grade or the higher Ka-67 on the spectrum. And as Dr. Hope said, in the truly high-grade tumors, the reverse is true. A lot of them are negative on the gallium-68 scan and positive on the sugar one, which is the FDG PET.
So Tom, I have a number of questions here, four or five, that address a similar topic. These are people who tend to live a long time relative to many other cancers. They tend to be scanned with DOTATOC, DOTATATE, Octrea scans, nuclear medicine scans, CT scans. When is a person had too many scans? And what would be an appropriate scanning frequency for somebody who's had their disease removed?
Okay, so that's a complicated question all in one there. So part of that question is about radiation dose and is there a cumulative dose from radiation from the imaging modalities that you should be concerned about as a patient? And at the doses that we're giving for a DOTATATE or DOTATOC PET or a CT scan, it's very difficult to even show that there's an incidence of cancer 20 years out that's associated with the scan that we're performing, but it's probably real. And so, because neuroendocrine tumor patients, particularly younger patients under the age of 40, will be getting years worth of scans, I don't think it's about should you not get the scan, but maybe should we be doing, if you have liver disease, MRIs, which don't have radiation, or changing the type of scan you do per se. But compared to, for example, PRRT, the dose of radiation is, many times fold different.
So I'm glad you said that, because the next question is, how many courses of PRRT can you take?
Okay, well, I answered one of three questions. Yeah. We're now to question four.
Sorry.
How many doses of PRRT? So that is a great question, the question here, I think, is more complicated, which is when and how often in the setting of other treatments should you do PRRT? So PRRT clearly is within the armamentarium, and we don't know exactly when to use it all the time, but because the data looks good, it seems that people are hoping to use it earlier on in the course, but there are many other therapies that are available. And so when do you use everolimus first or second? How long after a PRRT treatment should you retreat if there's progression? How does chemotherapy fit into this order? And I think all of those questions are fully untouched. So sequencing and timing is very important. A lot of it depends on how well you respond to PRRT. If you got PRRT, you had a good response, it shrunk, you're 6 years out from that PRRT and it recurs again, I think it's reasonable to think PRRT would be a good treatment. If you got PRRT, on the other hand, and it was stable but no shrinkage, and 1 year later it starts progressing, well, then you might not want to do PRRT and consider, everolimus or a chemotherapy regimen. So this we don't know the answer to, and this is why I'm glad we have people like this available to have these discussions.
So this is a question I'm only going to ask of Dr. Kunz, Dr. Welton, and Dr. Norton. It's a very specific question. There are dividers among us. Who does better scans, UCSF or Stanford? All right, I'm going to assume the audience knows the answer to that and move on.
That's my next talk.
Emily, you mentioned the immunotherapy trial that you're going to have for poorly differentiated. And we touched upon it a little bit, but there's clearly a lot of enthusiasm in the audience and many questions I won't address specifically. But how are we going to get to immunotherapy for the well-differentiated carcinoids and pancreatic neuroendocrine tumors? What do you see the opportunities or
Yeah, I mean, I think it's a really interesting question. I think the suspicion is, as Dr. Fisher already alluded to, is that at least the data we have to date suggests that the tumors that harbor the highest mutation rates or burdens seem to be the most responsive to immunotherapy using the traditional means that have been used so far. So I think no one's advocating, you know, this isn't something we can really fix about a tumor. You know, we know these neuroendocrine tumors are really relatively low mutation burden tumors. But it may be possible that there are things that we can do to help tweak the microenvironment or the system to help augment the immune response. And I think that's probably where the field is going. And really the first step is, as George outlined, is to really very carefully characterize the different types of neuroendocrine tumors that are out there and the immune microenvironment. What cells are in the environment? Does it correlate with the mutations? You know, can you basically find subtypes that might benefit? And then for the ones that are not likely to benefit, are there things you can do to actually augment the immune response with these agents?
I have one question for Dr. Welton, and I'm going to use this question because I've been asked many times by patients in my clinic. I had a small intestinal neuroendocrine tumor removed. How often do I need a colonoscopy?
I really think that depends on how concerned you are, because there'd be no medical reason to get a colonoscopy, because the neuroendocrine tumor in the small bowel is not going, with the medical knowledge that I have right now, is not going to put you at risk for anything in the colon. I do think that there's a sense of reassurance for some individuals that if the gastroenterologist said that he or she could get up there and take a look, that maybe, it, you know, at 3 years or something to take a look to make somebody feel a little bit more comfortable. But it's not from a science point of view or a medicine point of view. And you'd say, well, it shouldn't have been there in the first place, so why can't we go take a look? And so maybe there's an argument around that. But other than that, there's no medical reason that I'm aware of.
So it's five of. We promised that we'd have everyone done by four. I thought maybe we could wrap up and thank everyone for coming. Pam, I don't know if you have any closing comments, or Ron?
Thank you so much to the afternoon panel. Let's give everyone a round of applause here.